Hello, and welcome to our Good Friday liturgy today. You can find today's bulletin in the description of this video. I invite you to stand for the opening sentences. Blessed be our God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we pray you graciously to behold this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into the hands of sinners and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the lessons.
A reading from the Wisdom of Solomon. The ungodly reasoned unsoundly, saying to themselves, "Short and sorrowful is our life, and there is no remedy when a life comes to its end. And no one has been known to return from Hades. Let us lie in wait for the righteous man, because he is inconvenient to us and opposes our actions. He reproaches us for sins against the law and accuses us of sins against our training. He professes to have knowledge of God and calls himself a child of the Lord. He became to us a reproof of our thoughts. The very sight of him is a burden to us, because his manner of life is unlike that of others, and his ways are strange. We are considered by him as something base, and he avoids our ways as unclean. He calls the last end of the righteous happy, and boasts that God is his father. Let us see if his words are true, and let us test what will happen at the end of his life. For if the righteous man is God's child, he will help him and will deliver him from the hand of his adversaries. Let us test him with insult and torture, so that we may find out how gentle he is and make trial of his forbearance. Let us condemn him to a shameful death, for, according to what he says, he will be protected." Thus they reasoned, but they were led astray, for their wickedness blinded them, and they did not know the secret purposes of God, nor hoped for the wages of holiness, nor discerned the prize for blameless souls. For God created us for incorruption, and made us in the image of his own eternity, but through the devil's envy, death entered the world, and those who belong to his company experience it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in reading Psalm 22 in unison. My God, why have you forsaken me, and are so far from my cry, and from the words of my distress? Oh my God, I will cry in the daytime, but you do not answer. By night as well, but I find no rest. Yet you are the Holy One, enthroned upon the praises of Israel. Our forefathers put their trust in you. They
using hymn number 167, There Is a Green Hill Far Away.
Here is your king. They cried out, Away with him. Away with him, crucify him. Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but the emperor." Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on a cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write, 'The King of the Jews,' but, 'This man said, I am King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who will get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says, "They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified, so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled: "None of his bones shall be broken." And again, another passage of scripture says, "They will look on the one whom they have pierced." After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices and linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there.
Stand before you today in the name of God, who is known to us as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Every Good Friday, I like to give a little bit of a different kind of homily. Rather than explaining or kind of expounding on the Bible readings, which are powerful in their own right, especially today, I'd like to just tell a story. The story I'd like to share with you today is an old Korean folk tale called The Magpies and the Snake. Once, a long time ago, a young man was walking through the woods in the mountains where he lived. He came into a small clearing and was startled to hear the shrill call of a magpie. He looked up into the tree branches around him until he found the source of the cry. In the branches, a magpie stood over her nest, guarding her eggs in it. Facing the magpie was an enormous green snake, ready to attack the magpie and eat her eggs. The young man, seeing this, quickly slipped his bow and arrow that he was carrying off of his shoulder, and after just a moment's hesitation, he shot and killed the snake. The magpie turned to look at the man and chirped, "Thank you." The man replied with a little wave. Looking to the ground, the man walked over to where the dead snake had fallen. He felt some remorse that in order to save the magpie and her eggs, he had had to take the life of the snake. In his sadness, he dug a small grave for the reptile under the tree and buried it. Then the man returned home. Several months later, the man again found himself walking through the mountains. And he came to that same clearing in the trees where he had seen the magpie and the snake. He stopped and said a short prayer at the grave of the snake, and then he decided to sit down and listen to the birds for a while. As he sat and listened, the young man accidentally drifted off to sleep. With a start, the young man awoke and found that it was dusk. He got up and hurried back in the direction of his home. In the darkness, though, he lost his way and found himself walking through unfamiliar woods as dusk faded into night. Finally, when the darkness covered the mountains, the young man realized that he could go no further. He needed to stop for the night. He took shelter under a boulder, made a sleeping mat out of leaves, and eventually fell asleep. The young man awoke with a sudden feeling of tightness in his throat. He went to grab his neck only to find that he couldn't move his arms. "Help!" he called out weakly. "There's no one to help you," a raspy voice said. The man looked down to find a massive green snake coiled around his upper body. He struggled to break free, but the snake only tightened her grip. "You killed my son," the snake said. The man was terrified. He cried out feebly, "I'm sorry I killed him. I didn't do it out of hate or anger. I was only trying to protect the magpie and her eggs. In fact, I buried your son under the tree. Please, take pity on me." The snake loosened her grip just a bit. After a few moments of silence, she hissed, "I suppose you deserve some mercy. Here is what I propose. Somewhere in these mountains is an old temple with a magic bell that has not been tolled for 100 years. Find the bell and ring it 3 times before dawn, and I will turn into a dragon and you will be free. Fail to ring it and you will meet your end." The young man was happy to have a chance of survival. "I accept," he said. "Let me go so that I can find the bell." The snake chuckled a bit. "Not so fast. If I let you go, you can just run off. You must search for the bell with me wrapped around you." The man had no choice but to comply. When the snake loosened her hold a little bit more, the man stood up and began to hobble up and down the mountain. For hours, he walked in the darkness, carrying the huge green snake wrapped around his body, searching, searching, searching for the temple with a magic bell. He scoured the mountain he was on, then he scoured all the mountains near him, but no temple and no bell were to be found. Finally, as the sky was starting to lighten in the east, the young man collapsed with exhaustion and despair. "Can't find it," he admitted. The snake laughed an awful, cruel laugh and began to squeeze. Just as the man had thought this was the end, he heard quite near him a sound. Dong! The snake froze and listened. There it was again. Dong! The snake let go of the man completely. A third ring came. Dong! With a shriek, the snake transformed into a massive green dragon. And with a last look of both disappointment and gratitude towards the young man, she flew away. The man lay still and silent for a long time. Finally, he stood up stiffly and set off in the direction of the bells. Before long, he found the remains of a crumbling stone temple. Hanging in the middle of the temple was an enormous iron bell covered with moss and mold. On the stone floor of the temple lay 3 gravely injured magpies, their bodies bruised and battered from the impact of flying into the bell. The young man scooped them up and whispered, "Thank you." Knowing that the birds would surely die if he didn't care for them, the man carried them back to his home, nursed them to health, and released them back to their clearing. There is in the story of Jesus' passion and his death a powerful message of love. Like the magpies, Jesus was ready to give his own life so that others might live. I think, like this story, the story of Jesus' death is both deeply painful to hear and yet also beautiful in a way, because it speaks of a great, unconquerable love. In the story of the magpies and the snake, we can easily see ourselves as the young man and Jesus as the magpies who save us. But I wonder if there's another way to look at the story. Suppose we ourselves are the magpies who have been given new life, and now we are called to give up that life in some way in the service of our Savior and others. Amen. Would you please stand and join us in hymn number 168, O Sacred Head, Sore Wounded.
Thank you.
invite you to either remain standing or to kneel. Dear people of God, our Heavenly Father sent his Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved, that all who believe in him might be delivered from the power of sin and death, and become heirs with him of everlasting life. We pray, therefore, for people everywhere, according to their needs. Let us pray for the Holy Catholic Church of Christ throughout the world, for its unity in witness and service, for all bishops and other ministers and the people whom they serve, for Kevin, our bishop, and all the people of this diocese, for all Christians in this community, that God will confirm his church in faith, increase it in love, and preserve it in peace. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you, through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray for all nations and peoples of the earth, and for those in authority among them. For Joseph, the President of the United States, for the Congress and the Supreme Court, for the members and representatives of the United Nations, for all who serve the common good, that by God's help they may seek justice and truth and live in peace and concord. Almighty God, kindle, we pray, in every heart the true love of peace, and guide with your wisdom those who take counsel for the nations of the earth, that in tranquility your dominion may increase until the earth is filled with the knowledge of your love, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for all who suffer and are afflicted in body or in mind, for the hungry and the homeless, the destitute and the oppressed, for the sick, the wounded, and the mentally ill, for those in loneliness, fear, and addiction, for those who face temptation, doubt, and despair, for the sorrowful and bereaved, for prisoners and captives, and those in mortal danger, that God in mercy will comfort and relieve them, and grant them the knowledge of his love, and stir up in us the will and patience to minister to their needs. Gracious God, the comfort of all who sorrow, the strength of all who suffer, let the cry of those in misery and need come to you, that they may find your mercy present with them in all their afflictions. And give us, we pray, the strength to serve them for the sake of him who suffered for us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us commit ourselves to God and pray for the grace of a holy life, that with all who have departed this world and have died in the peace of Christ, and those whose faith is known to God alone, we may be accounted worthy to enter into the fullness of the joy of our Lord and receive the crown of life in the day of resurrection. O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery, by the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Behold the wood of the cross on which was hung the world's salvation. Glory in your cross, O Lord, and praise and glorify your holy resurrection, for by virtue of your cross, joy has come to the whole world. May God be merciful to us and bless us, show us the light of his countenance and come to us. Let your ways be known upon earth, your saving help among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. We glory in your cross, O Lord, and praise and glorify your holy resurrection. For by virtue of your cross, joy has come to the whole world. Would you join us as we sing hymn number 172, Were You There? Confess our sins against God and our neighbor. God of all mercy, we confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our lives. We have denied your goodness in each other, in ourselves, and in the world you have created. We repent of the evil that enslaves us, the evil we have done, and the evil done on our behalf. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us through our Savior Jesus Christ, that we may abide in your love and serve only your will.
Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us all our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life.
Amen.
Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, we pray you to set your passion, cross, and death between your judgment and our souls, now and in the hour of our death. Give mercy and grace to the living, pardon and rest to the dead, to your holy church, peace and concord, and to us sinners, everlasting life and glory. For with the Father and the Holy Spirit, you live and reign, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.